The adventure of the blue carbuncle continued. His remarks were suddenly cut short by a loud hubbub, which broke out from the stall which we had just left. Turning round, we saw a little rat-faced fellow standing in the center of the circle of yellow light, which was thrown by the swinging lamp, while Breckenridge, the salesman, framed the door of his stall, was shaking his fist fiercely at the cringing figure. "I've had enough of you and your geese," he shouted. "I wish you were all at the devil together. If you come pestering me any more with your silly talk, I'll set the dog at you. You bring Mrs. Oakshott here, and I'll answer her. But what have you to do with it? Did I buy the geese off you?" "No, but one of them was mine all the same," whined the little man. "Well then, ask Mrs. Oakshott for it. She told me to ask you." "Well, you can ask the King of Prussia for all I care. I've had enough of it. Get out of this." He rushed fiercely forward, and the inquirer flitted away into the darkness. "How this may seem as a visit to Brixton Road," whispered Holmes. "Come with me, and we will see what is to be made of this fellow." Striding through the scattered knots of people who lounged around the flaring stalls, my companion speedily overtook the little man and touched him upon the shoulder. He sprang round, and I could see in the gaslight that every vestige of color had been driven from his face. "Who are you, then?" "What do you want?" he asked in a quavering voice. "You'll excuse me," said Holmes blandly, "but I could not help overhearing the questions which you put to the salesman just now. I think that I could be of assistance to you." "You, who are you? How could you know anything of the matter?" "My name is Sherlock Holmes. It is my business to know what other people don't know." "But you can know nothing of this." "Excuse me, I know everything of it. You are endeavoring to trace some geese which were sold by Mrs. Oakshott of Brixton Road to a salesman named Breckenridge, by him in turn to Mr. Windigate of the Alpha, and by him to his club, of which Mr. Henry Baker is a member." "Oh, sir, you are the very man whom I have longed to meet," cried the little fellow with outstretched hands and quivering fingers. "I can hardly explain to you how interested I am in this matter." Sherlock Holmes hailed a four-wheeler which was passing. "In that case, we had better discuss it in a cozy room rather than in this windswept marketplace," said he. "But pray tell me, before we go farther, who it is that I have the pleasure of assisting." The man hesitated for an instant. "My name is John Robinson," he answered with a sidelong glance. "No, no, the real name," said Holmes sweetly. "It is always awkward doing business with an alias." A flush sprang to the white cheeks of the stranger. "Well then," said he, "my real name is James Ryder." "Precisely so. Head attendant at the Hotel Cosmopolitan. Pray step into the cab, and I shall soon be able to tell you everything which you would wish to know." The little man stood glancing from one to the other of us with half-frightened, half-hopeful eyes, as one who is not sure whether he is on the verge of a windfall or of a catastrophe. Then he stepped into the cab, and in a half an hour we were back in the sitting room at Baker Street. Nothing had been said during our drive, but the high, thin breathing of our new companion and the claspings and unclaspings of his hands spoke of the nervous tension within him. "Here we are," said Holmes cheerily as we filled into the room. "The fire looks very seasonable in this weather. You look cold, Mr. Ryder. Pray, take the basket chair. I will just put on my slippers before we settle this little matter of yours. Now then, you want to know what became of those geese, right?" "Yes, sir." "Or rather, I fancy, of that goose. It was one bird, I imagine, in which you were interested. White with a black bar across the tail?" Ryder quivered with emotion. "Oh, sir," he cried, "can you tell me where it went to?"
"It came here."
"Here? Yes, and a most unremarkable bird it proved. I don't wonder that you should take an interest in it. It laid an egg after it was dead, the bonniest, brightest little blue egg that ever was seen. I have it here in my museum." Our visitor staggered to his feet and clutched the mantelpiece with his right hand. Holmes unlocked his strong box and held up the blue carbuncle, which shone out like a star, with a cold, brilliant, many-pointed radiance. Ryder stood glaring with a drawn face, uncertain whether to claim or to disown it. "The game's up, Ryder," said Holmes quietly. "Hold up, man, or you'll be into the fire. Give him an arm back into his chair, Watson. He's not got blood enough to go in for felony with impunity. Give him a dash of brandy. So, now he looks a little more human. What a shrimp it is, to be sure." For a moment he had staggered and nearly fallen, but the brandy brought a tinge of color into his cheeks, and he sat staring with frightened eyes at his accuser. "I have almost every link in my hands and all the proofs which I could possibly need, so there is little which you need to tell me. Still, that little may as well be cleared up to make the case complete. You had heard, Ryder, of this blue stone of the Countess of Morcar's?"
"It was Catherine Cusack who told me of it," said he in a crackling voice.
"I see, her ladyship's waiting maid. Well, the temptation of sudden wealth so easily acquired was too much for you, as it had been for better men before you. But you were not very scrupulous in the means you used. It seems to me, Ryder, that there is the making of a very pretty villain in you.
You knew that this man, Horner, the plumber, had been concerned in some such matter before, and that the suspicion would rest the more readily upon him. What did you do then? You made some small job in my lady's room, you and your confederate Cusack, and you managed that he should be the man sent for. Then, when he had left, you rifled the jewel case, raised the alarm, and had this unfortunate man arrested. You then, Ryder threw himself down suddenly upon the rug and clutched at my companion's knees. For God's sake, have mercy, he shrieked. Think of my father or my mother. It would break their hearts. I never went wrong before. I never will again. I swear it. I'll swear it on the Bible. Oh, don't bring it into court. For Christ's sake, don't. Get back into your chair, said Holmes sternly. It is very well to cringe and crawl now, but you thought little enough of this poor Horner in the dock for a crime of which he knew nothing. I will fly, Mr. Holmes. I will leave the country, sir. Then the charge against him will break down. Hum, we will talk about that. And now let us hear a true account of the next act. How came the stone into the goose, and how came the goose into the open market? Tell us the truth, for there lies your only hope of safety. Ryder passed his tongue over his parched lips. I will tell you it just as it happened, sir, said he. When Horner had been arrested, it seemed to me that it would be best for me to get away with the stone at once, for I did not know at what moment the police might not take it into their hands to search me and my room. There was no police about the hotel where it would be safe. I went out as if on some commission, and I made for my sister's house. She had married a man named Oakshott and lived in Brixton Road, where she fattened fowls for the market. All the way there, every man I met seemed to me to be a policeman or a detective, and for all that it was a cold night, the sweat was pouring down my face before I came to Brixton Road. My sister asked me what was the matter, and I was so pale, but I told her that I had been upset by the jewel robbery at the hotel. Then I went into the backyard and smoked a pipe and wondered what it would be best to do. I had a friend once called Maudsley, who went to the bad and has just been serving his time in Pentonville. One day he had met me and fell into talk about the ways of thieves and how they could get rid of what they stole. I knew that he would be true for me, for I knew one or two things about him, so I made up my mind to go right on to Kilburn, where he lived, and take him into my confidence. He would show me how to turn the stone into money, but how to get to him in safety. I thought of the agonies I had gone through in coming from the hotel. I might at any moment be seized and searched, and there would be the stone in my waistcoat pocket. I was leaning against the wall at the time and looking at the geese, which were waddling around my feet, and suddenly an idea came into my head which showed me how I could beat the best detective that ever lived. My sister had told me some weeks before that I might have the pick of her geese for a Christmas present, and I knew that she was always as good as her word. I would take my goose now, and in it I would carry this, my stone, to Kilburn. There was a little shed in the yard, and behind this I drove one of the birds, a fine big one, white with a barred tail. I caught it, and prying its bill open, I thrust the stone down its throat as far as my finger could reach. The bird gave a gulp, and I felt the stone pass along its gullet and down into its crop. But the creature flapped and struggled, and out came my sister to know what was the matter. As I turned to speak to her, the brute broke loose and fluttered off among the others. "Whatever were you doing with that bird, Jem?" says she. "Well," I said, "you said you'd give me one for Christmas, and I was feeling which was the fattest." "Oh," says she, "we've set yours aside for you. Jem's bird, we call it. It's the big white one over yonder. There's 26 of them, which makes one for you and one for us, and 24 for the market." "Thank you, Maggie," says I, "but if this is all the same to you, I'd rather have that one I was handling just now." "The other is a good 3 pound heavier," said she, "and we fattened it expressly for you." "Never mind, I'll have the other and I'll take it now," said I. "Oh, just as you like," said she, a little huffed. "Which is it you want, then?" "That white one with the barred tail right in the middle of the flock."
"Oh, very well.
Kill it and take it with you." "Well, I did what she said, Mr. Holmes, and I carried the bird all the way to Kilburn. I told my pal what I had done, for he was a man that it was easy to tell a thing like that, too. He laughed until he choked, and we got a knife and opened the goose. My heart turned to water, for there was no sign of the stone, and I knew that some terrible mistake had occurred. I left the bird, rushed back to my sister's, and hurried into the backyard. There was not a bird to be seen there. "Where are they all, Maggie?" I cried. "Gone to the dealers, Jem." "Which dealers?" "Breckenridge of Covent Garden." "But was there another with a barred tail?" I asked, "the same as the one I chose?" "Yes, Jem, there were two barred-tailed ones, and I can never tell them apart." "Well, then, of course, I saw it all, and I ran off as hard as my feet would carry me to this man Breckenridge, but he had sold the lot at once, and not one word would he tell me as to where they had gone. You heard him yourselves tonight. Well, he has always answered me like that. My sister thinks I am going mad. Sometimes I think that I am myself. And now I am myself a branded thief, without ever having touched the wealth for which I sold my character. God help me, God help me." He burst into convulsive sobbing with his face buried in his hands. There was a long silence, broken only by his heavy breathing and by the measured tapping of Sherlock Holmes' fingertips upon the edge of the table. Then my friend rose and threw open the door. "Get out," said he. "What, sir? Oh, heaven bless you. No more words, get out." And no more words were needed. There was a rush, a clatter upon the stairs, the bang of a door, and the crisp rattle of running footfalls from the street. "After all, Watson," said Holmes, reaching up his hand for his clay pipe, "I am not retained by the police to supply their deficiencies. If Horner were in danger, it would be another thing, but this fellow will not appear against him, and the case must collapse. I suppose that I am commuting a felony, but it is just possible that I am saving a soul. This fellow will not go wrong again. He is too terribly frightened. Send him to jail now and you make him a jailbird for life. Besides, it is the season of forgiveness. Chance has put in our way a most singular and whimsical problem, and its solution is its own reward. If you will have the goodness to touch the bell, doctor, we will begin another investigation in which also a bird will be the chief feature."